Oh, what a day! What a lovely day!
Witness me, bloody! Witness!
Oh, what a film! What a lovely film!
Yeah, it's kind of hard to know what moment to open a Mad Max Fury Road analysis with, but I chose this one because Fury Road is not Max's story, and I would say it's not even Furiosa's story. The most transformative character is Nux. This moment of pure insanity is why Nicholas Holt keeps coming up as the possible next big super something, and in Fury Road, he is demanding us bloodbags in the audience to witness his rebirth from war boy to human being. And it all comes down to this shiny chrome spray, a horrible truth that Nux overcomes in this movie. And we're gonna talk about why this movie is so smart to ask who killed the world, but never explicitly, condescendingly answer that question, as much as we may deserve it. I'm Erik Voss, and this is The Deep Dive, a channel that dives deep into the thorny thicket of cinema glory to uncover the long-lost green places erased from memory. Mad Max Fury Road is one of the best action movies of all time. And here in Survive September on The Deep Dive, we must break it down for the impressive attention to detail that George Miller and his team worked into it. So, over the opening Warner Brothers title, we hear the revving of an engine. Mad Max Fury Road is the fourth film in George Miller's Mad Max series, after 1979's Mad Max, 1981's The Road Warrior, 1985's Beyond Thunderdome, and Miller, all the way back in 1987, already started gestating the idea for Fury Road, wanting to make it a film that was almost a continuous chase, in his words, or as Guy Norris, the stunt coordinator and the second unit director of this film, put it.
The first half of the film is an enormous chase. The second half of the film is a race.
This movie never stops, and these opening engine roars signal the audience that it's time to start our engines. But don't even bother buckling up. We hear the voice of Tom Hardy as Max Rockatansky.
My name is Max. My world is fire and blood.
So Hardy was cast replacing Mel Gibson after this fourth film stayed in development hell for decades. Everything kept getting in the way, and George Miller moved on to shoot films like Babe and Happy Feet, if you can believe it. Gibson ended up aging out of the role, but Tom Hardy still carries this role with the weight of a man beyond his years. That's kind of why the character just seems older than Tom Hardy is. Many of Tom Hardy's lines are dubbed in this movie. Hardy admitted that he had no idea while they were shooting it what Miller was trying to do with it. Hardy was reportedly pretty hard to work with, and later he actually apologized to the director during the film's premiere at Cannes. Over the credits, we hear these words.
Why are you hurting these people?
It's the oil, stupid.
The world is actually running out of water.
There's the water wars.
Yes, we hear male voices reporting on the oil wars. It's the oil wars, stupid. But then female voices correct. Actually, the world is running out of drinkable water, too. See, the truth is there, but this movie doesn't really hit us over the head with it. Max references his past.
Once, I was a cop. A road warrior searching for a righteous cause.
Yes, road warrior coming up there. Max was a cop in that first 1979 film, which totally seems tame compared to how the franchise would evolve. Really, it was Road Warrior where you could say George Miller started to realize his true vision for this nutso post-apocalyptic world. Then, our true opening shot.
It was hard to know who was more crazy. Me. Or everyone else.
What a lovely shot!
George Miller worked with colorist Eric Whip to oversaturate every scene to look like a graphic novel. He wanted a contrast to the post-apocalyptic films that tended to be desaturated at the time. They shot this film in the deserts of Namibia, and in post-production, they colored the sand to be deep golden orange and the sky to be this radiant blue. It is glowing off the screen, radioactive, since this planet has been nuked to shit, according to the opening titles. The precise composition of many of the shots in this movie comes from George Miller spending years storyboarding this movie out shot by shot with the artists.
It was 3,500 panels around a room, and I would say a good 80% of those panels are reflected in the images you see on the screen today.
Seriously, read the PDF of the screenplay for this movie that Nico Lathouris and Brendan McCarthy composed. It's a hybrid of storyboard art with exposition and dialogue. It's like an incredible graphic novel. And you can see that intentionality in every frame of this movie. Max stands beside this beat up V8 Interceptor, the Pursuit Special, the TT Falcon muscle car that he drove in the first two films until it explodes in The Road Warrior and does not appear in Beyond Thunderdome. How did he get it back? Well, a four-part prelude comic that was co-credited to George Miller shows the backstories of Nux and Immortan Joe and Furiosa when she meets the wives, and of course Max. We learn that this story is set after Beyond Thunderdome, and Max goes to Gastown to fight in a Thunderdome Plus to win a new V8 engine. Throughout this opening sequence, he's haunted by the people he let die, including this girl. Her name is Glory. Her mother had saved Max during a conflict with the Buzzards after that Thunderdome Plus win, and one of the Buzzards stabbed Max in the femoral artery in the leg, and that is the one who later runs over Glory and her mom, and we see flashes of that here. And that is where we find Max now. Hearing their voices haunting him.
Help us, Max. You promised to help us.
Yes, he stomps out their voices, kicks up that double-headed lizard, and just gobbles it whole. Of course, the lizard mutated probably by radioactive fallout, but this two-headed lizard, I believe, symbolizes Max in this movie. Our man is handcuffed to Nux as the War Boy's blood bag, and later tethered spiritually to Furiosa in order to survive and reach redemption. Max takes off in the V8 Interceptor, and the buzzards flip him. What an opening stunt! It's actually a reference to the famous T-Bone stunt in Road Warrior, in which Guy's leg clipped the car and his body went limp, so he flipped over and over. Here, they wanted to go for a record with the Interceptor flipping, and they actually used a mechanical arm that would suddenly drop down and flip the car. And it just looks great. Guy drove the car himself here for the stunt, but Miller masks an edit with a cloud of dust so that when we push in on the car, it's hairy, hairy Tom Hardy. Max calls himself
a man reduced to a single instinct. Survive.
Survive! And the best way to support the deep dive this month is with one of our Survive the Dive shirts at nerdriot.shop. Angus Sampson plays the organic mechanic. He's not a doctor, but in this car-worshipping dystopia, he's kind of a mechanic of organs. And he tattoos Max's back, and I love this. If you look at the concept art, you can see that it is day 12045, and they measure his height in hands, as one would do with a horse. They write, piss okay, genitals intact, heals fast, O plus, universal donor. They write down where they found him, no guzzling or supplies on him, and they say, isolate this iconic, keep masked. And they do this upside down because as a blood bag, he would hang like a human IV drip. Now, since this movie is a chase, Miller already uses rapid cutting. This is actually edited by Miller's wife, Margaret Sixel, who cut down 480 hours of footage it took 3 months to watch through. They ended up with 2,700 cuts in 120 minutes, which is 22.5 cuts per minute. Miller brought in director of photography, John Seale, out of retirement to shoot this movie, and Seale said that 50-60% is running at the normal 24 frames per second, but sometimes below 24 frames per second to slow it down, as Miller and Sixel would manipulate every single shot to fit into that storyboard vision. In order to accomplish this, Miller told Seale to take the atypical move of framing every single shot of the movie so that the visual focus is at the center of frame, unlike the normal one-third of the line of frame, so that when Miller and Sixel would later edit, they could rapid cut from shot to shot and the viewer's eye would not have to move across the frame. And you see that here with a shot of the hot brand pushing in, cutting immediately to Hardy's reaction shot in the same part of the frame. Really, it's the skull pushing in at him, triggering him over letting Glory die, that forces Max to fight free. At one point, Max shoves his wrist chains through the mouth of this War Boy. This is Slit, Nux's Lancer, whom we later see with his cheeks stapled shut. I thought this might be the origin of those scars, but in an interview with Elka Wardega and Damian Martin, they implied that these cuts were self-inflicted, so, you know, Max might have just pushed the staples out here. Ugh. Max runs through the apparitions of the people he let die, including this guy with a very memorable nose. We actually see this guy in the final moments of the film cheering to show Max finally free from these ghosts. The doors Max pushes out through are actually the doors of an ambulance vehicle. You can see the Star of Life symbol on those muddy door windows because this was the organic mechanic's doctor office. When Max swings on the hook, one of the War Boys falls to his death. Yes, you can hear it clear. Yes! Because these War Boys want to die in the course of the pursuit, it means that he's gonna go to Valhalla! Our first shot of Furiosa, Charlize Theron, shows the back of her neck branded with that Immortan Joe sigil, a skull on a steering wheel that Max fled away from. And she hooks up this gnarly steering wheel to the war rig. In the in-universe mythology, the steering wheels are detachable because they are granted to you by the will of the Immortan, and then returned to the altar room that contains the wheels of warriors past and present. Cross-cutting with these shots of Furiosa are shots of Immortan Joe's ailing, tumor-stricken body as he's covered with service metal armor that gives him a fake muscular appearance. Joe's medals include an Easy Rider badge and then a 500 that looks like the 500 that's part of the Australian Ford Falcon logo. His skull steering wheel is hooked into his crotch region, of course. It's designed in a way so that the chainmail hangs from it, mimicking the water that pours from the giant carving of the skull in the side of the rock, which is Joe's true power over these masses. This armor piece is also worn by Joe's deformed sons, who have the best names, Corpus Colossus, ironically the small one, the mentally slow Rictus Erectus, but there's also a third son, Scabrous Scrotus. I know. Also, you'll notice Rictus Erectus wears a necklace of baby heads, because of course he does. He probably thinks they make him smarter. So Joe in this movie is played by Hugh Kays Byrne, who played Toe Cutter in the original 1979 film. The character's backstory is detailed in one of those prelude comics. He was war veteran Colonel Joe Moore, who took this aquifer by force. He lost a ton of followers, but he somehow survived, earning the moniker of Immortan. immortal. Furiosa in these prelude comics was brought in by Joe as an imperator to guard Joe's wives. The Splendid Angerhead, the Dag, Toast the Knowing, Cheeto the Fragile, and Capable. So Joe has a war boy blow white powder on his tumors to ease his pain, and this white powder is inspired by the makeup of Indian holy men, but this ghostly pallor is mimicked by all of the war boys, with darkened eyes making them look like the skull of his citadel. During Joe's speech, the war boys do this prayer salute, interlocking their fingers, four on each side, making it look like the eight valves of the V8 engine. That's why they chant, V8, V8! So Joe cranks on the water for just a few seconds, but then cruelly turns it off, saying,
"Do not, my friends, become addicted to water."
And later on, Max's dependency on the water from the hose is one vulnerability that Furiosa and the wives will take advantage of. Now, when the war-rigged platform goes back up, you can actually see a lone woman who was allowed to stay on that elevator. This is actually from a wild deleted scene in which Deborah Ades plays a desperate woman who offers her baby to be a war boy. The baby is rejected, and then she hands off the baby to a girl and then says, "Then take me, I'm a Milka." Yeah, I think this was a solid cut. As Furiosa takes off, she checks her mirror to see the mirrored light signal between the Citadel and Gas Town. She waits until after they have started signaling each other before she veers off. This way, she gets the best head start. We see how Joe had kept his wives behind a literal bank vault door, because for him, they were his possessions. In the sanctuary, we see five chairs set out before a chalkboard. In the prelude comic, we learn that these were for lessons from Miss Giddy, who you can see here is covered in tattoos, because she is a word burger, a history man or history person we see here who acts as a living book with names and stories tattooed on their skin. Storyboard artist Mark Sexton said that they originally planned to have this movie narrated by a history man, who was an older man trying to remember the facts and figures, kind of an unreliable narrator, but instead they used this framing device for the prelude comic, and then they ended this movie with a quote from the first history man. Now, we learned in that comic the wives had begged Miss Giddy to come with them, but she decided to stay behind with a gun to stall the pursuit for as long as possible.
"You cannot own a human being. Sooner or later, someone pushes back."
And written all over the place are phrases like, "Our babies will not be warlords. Who killed the world? We are not things," and they are all written in white, the color of mother's milk. As the chase begins, Nux hears the drums of the doof wagon. We don't see the front of it yet, just the back of it, and it's just so cool looking that we don't even notice that Warboy Lancer swinging into frame toward us until he lands. Production designer Colin Gibson said that the name doof came from the sound of the speakers. Doof, doof, doof. And that every army needs a drummer boy. Here we get a drummer vehicle, and later on they're able to tell how close Joe is based on the sound of the guitar. Slit tries to take Nux's wheel since he's alien, and the organic mechanic says,
"You're already a corpse."
Yeah, he's referring to the two tumors on Nux's neck. Nux has a half-life. He knows that his time is limited and he wants to go out in a blaze of glory, and using Max as his mobile blood bag is part of that plan.
"It's got a muzzle on it. It's a raging feral."
Yeah, the headbutt comes with a flash of lightning. Max's blood is treated as a kind of legendary elixir, at least from Nux's point of view. That's why Nux straps Max on the front of the car to freak Max out and then feed that adrenaline back into his own bloodstream. Now, Nux's origin was shown in the first part of the prelude comic as a boy who desperately held on to the Citadel elevator like that woman did, following his sick mother and a father who died working at the top of the Citadel, and one of the guards called him a tough nut to crack, which led to the nickname of Nux. So Max ends up strapped to the front of Nux's Chevy coupe, just as the hostages of Lord Humongous were in Road Warrior. And during this chase, we see the front of the doof wagon, one of the craziest images of the movie, Coma the Doof Warrior, real-life musician Iota, playing a real-life practical flaming guitar, the flame controlled with the whammy bar. Coma wears a leather mask as he's blind, and this is apparently skin from the character's dead mother's face. And when we see him sleeping later, his hammock is made out of guitar straps, and you'll notice as Chuck Taylor's soles are not worn down because our man's feet never touch the ground. We see Immortan Joe car, the Giga Horse. It actually has a body made up of two 59 Cadillac Coupe de Villes stacked on top of each other. Nux calls out to Joe.
"Immortan Joe! He looks right at me!
He looks at your blood bag!"
Now, in the shot before this, you see that Max had been looking at Joe moments before, and I really do think Joe was looking at this insane sight of a blood bag on a car. Max and Joe actually never really talk to each other or do much interacting with each other in this movie, other than this moment right here, and later when Max hijacks the People Eater's limousine and then they shoot at each other. But the conflict in this movie is not directly between Max and Joe. They don't really have any personal antagonism toward each other. And I just love how Nux's entire sense of destiny comes from this misread moment, where a glance was meant for someone else. But that misread glance is a crucial spark in this movie's plot, because now Nux speeds ahead of Joe, putting himself, and really Max, at the tip of the spear. Max screams, "Yes, this is believed to be Latin for f*** it or I am f***ed, That's why he accentuates the f- of it. Joe's armada fires these flares, red and yellow, one color for reinforcements from Gastown, another for reinforcements from the bullet farm. But the buzzards get there first. Yeah, they're speaking Russian here, but apparently in the Russian dub, they speak German. This presents an interesting dilemma for Furiosa. She must deceive her own war boy crew into helping her fend off the buzzards, knowing that falling back to Joe will mean capture and death. This whole chase just kind of feels like an homage to John Ford's Stagecoach. The reason this movie works is it's just classic American Western cinema. While Nux's pedal has the word Nux written on it, Furiosa's pedal is a woman's shoe size measure, so it won't work if a men's size boot tries to drive it or without Furiosa's unique switch sequence. So it's not just the steering wheel that was religiously granted to her by Immortan Joe, it's her own magic spots that only she knows the location of. Right above Max's head is this interesting skull with goggles, which many believe could be the gyro captain from Road Warrior, but the goggles are different, so I'm not really sure. It later gets cut by the buzzard's buzzsaw and it goes beneath the truck with the grenades, blowing it up. So he does kind of have a redemptive moment. Morsov, plugged with arrows, sprays his mouth with silver spray and leaps onto the spikes. They actually did the stunt practically. They had the stunt actor leap with wires as the cars were all moving and they had the wires pull him back at the last second, but still, dangerous. And this insane death needs to be witnessed by Max up close. He's right there so that he knows what it means later when Nux sprays. After Morsov's death, Slit screams, "Mediocre!" refusing to give Morsov a respectful witness. Furiosa tries to lose them in a colossal sandstorm and the imagery just turns bonkers. Fiery red sand tornadoes and lightning. Where is the lightning coming from? Even for this movie, we are not grounded in any visual reality here, but it works. And why does it work? Because we are seeing it from Nux's point of view. Even Max is looking at this from over Nux's shoulder. And Nux is high as shit. Not just on Max's blood, but the chrome. So, the chrome, let's talk about it. Miller based the idea on spraying someone's mouth on a 1981 documentary called Frontline, following a Tasmanian-born combat veteran, Neil Davis, in South Vietnam and Cambodia during the war, and he said that he saw Cambodian soldiers holding these jaded deities in their mouths with these little straps as they ran into battle. So Miller merged this idea with the concept of chroming or huffing, which of course involves inhaling toxic chrome paint to get high, but for this prop, they actually used an aerosol cake paint sprayer, which the actor said would taste disgusting. But the idea is, Immortan Joe would lace this chrome with a drug that would put the war boy in a euphoric state and make him more open to death, ensuring the war boy's dying fealty. So basically, we are now seeing Nux in a crosswinds of two toxins, Immortan Joe's suicide serum and Max's lifeblood, two polar extremes. And the result is this insane visual, a devilish fever dream in which Nux witnesses the extreme of life and death mixed together in one storm. So Nux lights a flare to set ablaze his fuel and he prays,
"I live, I die, I live again."
But Max, with divine intervention, stops the flare. Furiosa rams a Chevy and the flare is left in the sand, snuffed out. So in a way, Nux's prayer is answered, but not in the way he expects. This moment, deliverance from both Max and Furiosa working together, this delivers Nux and we witness the death of the boy and from here forward, the resurrection of the man. When Max wakes up in the sand, his hearing is muffled until the second he yanks out the bloodline hooked to Nux. He was stuck in the death of Nux's indoctrination until he severed the link. So now at this point in the movie, we see Max looking like his Road Warrior self, the sawed-off shotgun that jams, the metallic leg brace that he wore in Road Warrior, presumably from that knee injury he got when he was shot at the end of the 1979 Mad Max. He gets his Road Warrior jacket back from Nux, and Max drinks the hose water, the same water that we see waking up Nux, beginning his slow detox process. Max motions for the bolt cutters, and the DAG begins to hand them to Furiosa, but Max makes her do it, because Max knows that with Furiosa's one arm, she couldn't possibly operate them, and she would only use these as a blunt weapon, as she definitely does when DAG tosses her the cutters during the scuffle. I just love how all this goes down non-verbally. Again, the merits of storyboarding. And there's some great sound mixing, like when Furiosa fires a gun right by Max's ear. That ring lingers for the next several seconds, as a gunshot that close to your ear definitely would temporarily deafen you. Fall is here, and whether you're headed back to school or just want to learn something new to shake off a summer's worth of brain fog, it's a great time to try learning a new language with Babbel. Babbel is scientifically proven to help you start speaking a new language in just 3 weeks. It's one of the top language learning apps in the world. Babbel's lessons are designed by real language teachers, and a Babbel subscription even comes with 2 free live classes. Babbel's method is simple. It teaches you real-world world conversations, so you are prepared to have practical conversations about travel, business, relationships, and more. Even if you're brand new to a language, Babbel can help.
Aprendo español, puedes repetir?
If you're really in love with a language, get a lifetime subscription so you can really feel fluent. But if not, there are monthly options available as well. No matter what you need, Babbel has you covered. Click the link in the description or scan the QR code to get 60% off your Babbel subscription today. Max shoots the pregnant Angharad through the leg, which will prove to be a critical wound later when she loses her footing on her fall from the war rig. And I love how initially Max plans to wait for Joe to arrive. The movie could have ended right here. Furiosa tries three different things. She tries to appeal to his fear of Joe's wrath for damaging one of his wives, his favorite wife. That doesn't work. Then she tries to tell Max to run for it. He'll get a good head start, but nope, he's still sitting. And then finally she says the thing that he wants.
You want that thing off your face?
Junkie XL's music in this film does not miss a beat. The entire film is a dialogue between sight and sound, just as it's a dialogue of glances and grunts between these two road warriors. They both just want freedom. It's one of many things that this movie does really well. It does not talk down to its audience with a condescending agenda or force anyone to apologize for anything. It only asks, do you want to survive? Great, let's just get through this shit together. And then it skips right to doing that work. And the characters, for so long in this movie, still do not trust each other or give each other reasons to trust each other. Like here, Max collects all the guns. So many guns. And during this, Dag insults him.
He's a crazy Smeg who eats Schlanger.
Yes, Smeg is kind of an all-purpose insult derived from Smegma, whereas Schlanger kind of equates to dick. We see Capable and Angharad looking out at the horizon to see Gastown boys with a telescope and binoculars that look like ones that Max and the Gyro Captain use in Road Warrior. Furiosa's side mirror was shot and broken during the Buzzard's raid, which now explains why she doesn't see Nux running up to the rig from behind. Later on, she saves a hand mirror to fix it. Now, the wives refuse to let Furiosa kill Nux. They take pity on him for being a kid at the end of his half-life, but they still shout out Nux's culty talking points.
We're not to blame.
Then who killed the worm?
Yeah, Nux doesn't have an answer, but as he sits with one of their shawls, we see some of his war boy white paint has begun to wear off, as it does gradually throughout this movie as our man deprograms. Now, George Miller brought in Eve Ensler, author of the Vagina Monologues, to consult on the sexual violence in the film, and Ensler said that she was blown away by the depth of the script that was there before she arrived, and really she just spent a week in Namibia advising the actors. Again, Angharad asks who killed the world, but leaves the answer implicit, and doing it this way, the script does not give room for bad faith contrarians to take any answer out of context for their own counter agendas. This movie moves so fast and is so much fun to look at, it doesn't give the haters time to hate. You can say so much more by just making a good movie. Furiosa drives them through a canyon after making a deal with the Rock Riders for 3,000 gallons of gasoline so that they'll block off the path, a deal that's compromised since Joe has now summoned both the forces of Gastown and the Bullet Farm. We meet the Bullet Farmer, a guy completely adorned with bullets, and his car is named the Peacemaker.
All this for a family squabble. Healthy babies.
We also meet the People Eater, leader of Gastown, and he's a fascinating figure. He's fattened from cannibalism, he's got a metal nose cap to cover rot from leprosy, he wears a gas mask catheter, and has handcuff-shaped pincers on his nipples, because, you know, he's into that kind of thing. The inside of his limo we see later includes a steering wheel with human hair, he's got an abacus for tabulating lost gas and lost men, he's got a gear shift of a revolver and a water faucet knob. Yeah, he's kind of an amalgam of everything bad about people and capitalism. If anybody killed the world, it's this guy, a hoarder of fossil fuels. As the Rock Riders jump over the war rig tossing grenades, we get more great examples of center-framed action. We go from the bulbous fuel pod pushing in on this, to a biker jumping the rig, Max in the cab, another boom, Furiosa shooting, Max shooting, and then to Angharad's womb, and we push in on that just as we did the fuel pod. The two bulbs framed with equal importance because guzzoline is equated with actual life in this dystopia. And throughout the sequence, we start to see Max and Furiosa begrudgingly collaborating. Like Furiosa has shown trust by showing Max her ignition sequence, and Max shows trust by loading and reloading for Furiosa while he drives. There's no time to argue about gender politics, survival forces pragmatic role-playing. And we see how Furiosa still needs Max during this. She's not taking over because Toast is too slow at reloading the gun, so Max just takes care of it with his handgun. Meanwhile, Nux has relapsed. He offers to kill Furiosa for Immortan Joe, and Joe sprays more of that chrome on Nux's mouth, and you can see the intoxicating release, finally a daddy who wants me. And Nux has his big chance to prove himself and then immediately humiliates himself.
Furiosa.
And it is the chain that Nux used for his blood bag that catches the grate, and Joe echoes Slit's immature insult of mediocre. And this is Nux's you'll shoot your eye out nightmare, but really, if you think about it, it was Nux's bloodline umbilical cord to his real papa, Max, that saves him from this moral relapse. The boys spear the rig's wheel, Furiosa clamps on a wrench, but they have to swipe a rock, and that knocks Inkarid. She falls off and goes under Joe's car. So the one thing keeping Joe from torching all of them is gone. Max is the one who sees her go under, and he's haunted back to that same framing of Inkarid as the dead girl, Glory. And even though it seems like Inkarid didn't fully go under the wheels, that's what Max sees. He makes a choice for all of them because he knows they cannot turn around. That choice is what Furiosa sees and trusts in Max when he says,
"She went under the wheels."
And now in this moment, while Joe's breathing mask is supposed to be sealed for this one scene, that toothy design opens as he screams in rage over Inkarid. They designed a separate prop just to characterize the character. That's what good masks are supposed to do, characterize. And it's so cool that they did this. And yeah, this movie at this point smartly shows all the characters cracking under pressure, wavering from their convictions, hesitant to trust. Like Cheeto the Fragile tries to give up and run back to the War Boys after they lose Inkarid. That's what it means to have fully realized human characters. Sometimes they break, sometimes they retreat. It's another reason why this movie's so good. Capable finds Nux in the back cab and she takes pity on him. He's shivering like someone literally in withdrawal.
I should be walking with the Immortan, not feasting with the heroes full time.
Yes, McFeasting. I love it. The corporate branding of the fast food empire of the days past has still permeated through this apocalypse. They drive through this muddy region that's shaded blue as a director of photography, John Seal, shot this day for night, overexposing the camera by up to 2 f-stops and recoloring it blue to give this landscape a blue yet still high contrast look so that we can see everything. And this place, we learn later, was the green place. So if structurally the loss of Inkarid seemed to come too early before the film's midpoint, we know that a deeper heartbreak is coming. Similarly, there are ways for Joe to get even angrier and to escalate, like when the organic mechanic reports that Inkarid's baby would have been a viable male.
I had a little baby brother! And it was perfect!
And actually, if you looked closely at the doctor's wrist, he totally has a tattoo of Charles Darwin's Tree of Life sketching. And I love this little moment from Nux.
This high ground, just beyond that thing.
He means the tree.
Yeah, tree.
Yeah, Nux doesn't know what a tree is, and it takes women educated by Miss Giddy the Word Burger to explain the concept of tree. Now, while Max has been pretty good with handguns in this movie, with a long-range rifle, not as much. So Furiosa takes over, but Furiosa still needs Max.
Don't breathe.
She needs Max's steadiness, his ability to control his breathing. So again, the need for survival is what leads to pragmatic role-playing. And again, a shot right by Max's ear leaves us with some ringing for a moment. So the bullet farmer is now blinded and he prays madly. Yeah, Heckler & Koch is the German weapons company that manufactures the submachine guns he is now using. But really, my favorite choice of this part of the movie is despite throughout Mad Max Fury Road showing us every bit of action, every death in full detail, in close-up, center-framed, now George Miller uses restraint when it comes to showing how Max kills the bullet farmer. We don't see what goes down. Max just returns with a new wheel, more guns, and he's covered in someone else's blood from an honest day's work. Why don't we see it? Well, it's because this movie isn't singularly Max's story. It's all of humanity's story. And humanity will always be blind to certain battles that some people fight so that we can all move forward. They drive past these creepy crow fishers on stilts. Now, Furiosa was a member of the Vuvalini, aka the Many Mothers, which was an all-female matriarchal tribe who would banish their males to these swamps, and they became these crow fishers. And according to concept art and a backstory from George Miller and Colin Gibson that was shared with Empire Magazine in November 2015, the Vuvalini would attack crow fishers on the regular when those men reached puberty, or the term used was sperm milking. They did this to keep their matriarchal society going. Therefore, Furiosa went from the sexual violence of one cult to perpetuating sexual violence in another cult, and she carries that guilt with her.
They're looking for hope.
What about you?
Redemption.
Now, if this were Max's story, we would cut to Max's reaction on this line, but no, we cut to Nux. Nux also realizes that he needs redemption. Whether or not Max finds redemption in the story isn't really crucial to the plot. He just needs survival. He is here to help deliver redemption for these other characters. He is their vehicle. He is their rig. Now, this nude woman cries in a tower, and Tom Hardy gives us the meme.
That's bait.
And he's totally right, it is bait. This is how the Vuvalini would trap them in for their creepy sperm milking. Now, while George Miller and Margaret Sixel throughout this movie rapid cut, here they stay in one heavy 35-second take as it dawns on Furiosa that the green place is gone.
Home. The green place.
But if you came from the west, you passed it.
And without cutting here, we stay on Charlize as the voices fade away around her.
The soil.
We had to get out.
We had no water. And
the water was filth.
It was poisoned. It was sour.
And then the crows came.
We couldn't grow anything.
And I think it's one of the most striking shots of any film, at least in the last decade, right here. Furiosa dropping her arms, staggering out in the windswept desert sand, wiping clean any of her hopes as she collapses to her knees. This is agony defined. These rolling dunes evoke Lawrence of Arabia, but whereas that was a story of an idealist preaching nothing is written, this is a story of a realist realizing that she cannot escape her fate, that she is doomed to the wasteland. Now that night, they see a satellite still in orbit and they speculate on the idea of TV.
Shows. Everyone in the old world had a show.
Now, while this line shows how history definitely became bastardized over the years, there is still some truth to it, as increasingly everyone has had a podcast or a YouTube channel or some kind of social media presence where they present a production of ourselves. And this is just a good reminder to all of you watching on YouTube that places like Twitter are not real life. Furiosa invites Max to join them on their westward trek across the Salt Plains, and he tells her,
"You know, hope is a mistake. If you can't fix what's broken, you'll go insane."
Now, Max is right in his diagnosis, but flawed in his prescription. Hope is a mistake, but only if you assume that you just can't fix what's broken. The answer then is really a simple mechanic logic in this car-driven world. Well, then fix what's broken. Hope is only a mistake if you just sit there idly in your hope and don't take action to fix it. So here at the start of the final act, we circle back to our opening image of Max. And again, looking out over an expanse by himself, his ride immediately to his left. For all we know, it could be the end of his story, but he has not fixed what's broken. He's still haunted.
Where are you? Help us. You promised to help us.
The voice of Glory returns, just as it was in that opening scene. But for a single frame, Miller and Sixel cut in this guy. This is a man who will later fire a crossbow at Max's head. So really, the ghost of Glory here, this premonition, saves Max later from a fatal headshot. So Max catches up to them on the plains, and he proposes to go back directly the way they came to take the undefended Citadel and make that their green place. I just really admire the simple lateral movement of this movie. It moves east for the first half, and then just turns around and goes back west for the second. Toast plays this little wind-up music box. This is the same one that Max has in The Road Warrior and gives to the feral kid. Now, from this, there was a theory that Tom Hardy's Max, this character, was a grown-up version of that kid, but George Miller has debunked it. He's just Max. So whereas the first half of the movie was a chase, now it's a race back home. The pursuers harpoon the milk tank. According to sound designer Mark Mangini, the war rig is meant to be Moby Dick. Joe is the doomed Captain Ahab. So these sounds of the rig were layered with whale calls, and the spraying milk was mixed in with the sound of whale blowholes. And when the rig is later destroyed, Mangini used slow down bear growls to make it sound like an animal wheezing its final breaths. This whole idea came actually from Steven Spielberg's Duel, in which he characterized the death of the truck by mixing in its wreck sounds with animal sounds. And really, the whole way they're trying to anchor this war rig and slow it down is like the men in Spielberg's Jaws trying to slow the shark with barrels fired by harpoon. And as soon as Max clears this obstacle, the harpoons, we get only a second to catch our breath before the next wave comes in, the polecats. George Miller pitched these early on after seeing street performers, and he wasn't really sure how this could be done safely without VFX, but Guy Norris brought in Stephen Bland from Cirque du Soleil, and they used actual poles that were strong and flexible enough using a counterweight at the base of the poles. And they actually show these counterweight operators at the base of every pole in the car. So by showing the work, Miller lets us know that there is real weight to these and thus real danger. And I love how we can see that they actually dress up the counterweight as an engine part. The editing in this section is just incredible. And at one point, Max falls. And again, more great center-framed action cutting. Furiosa catches him with her prosthetic arm in the center. She pays the price of that by taking a horrendous blow, again in the center, from the same archer who had plugged that arrow in Max's hand. Then an insane stunt I don't understand the physics of, from the undercarriage, Nux kicks Max into the People Eater's limo, like he kind of flies up on it. Now at this point, Max is behind the wheel in a different vehicle. He could make his escape, but he realizes Furiosa is hurt, hurt bad, because she saved him. So he leaps back onto the rig and he pays the price for it. He's snatched by the polecat and he comes within inches of the ground, but he releases the polecat, leading to, I think, another favorite shot of this movie. The fuel truck explodes in the background and Max swings in the foreground. Like Richard Dreyfuss in Jaws, he needs something for scale, and Max is what we have for scale. It looks so glorious. And we can actually see the doof wagon in the shot too. And in the background left, you can see how Joe's crew has been recovering all of their damaged vehicles and taking them with them. It's all here in the shot, and it's awesome. Now this truck was remote controlled and detonated practically with over 1,000 liters of petrol and homemade explosive initiator. So it's a real explosion, they just composited separately the polecat stunt in the foreground. But compositing the doof wagon in this shot was very important because, of course, we next see Max polecatting onto that, because nothing in this movie is just set dressing, it all gets used as a functional stage for some of the action. Max uses this double-necked guitar to whack the war boy, and after Max jabs the guitarist, the guitar slings back into his hands, and he just smiles and keeps playing. I love it. Now, for the next 3 minutes, it's just a perfectly storyboarded and cut sequence of action and reaction, cause and effect. Collaboration between the characters, all of it perfectly centered. Like Cheeto the Fragile surrenders herself, and we're worried because we saw her try to give up earlier. But here, it's really just a tactic from her to use her fragile status and reputation to help Furiosa get into Joe's cab. Every character in this movie has an arc. The Vuvolini gives Max an assist, shooting out Rictus's oxygen tank, which Max then uses to pummel him. Toast pulls back Joe's revolver, and Furiosa uses that opening to hook his mask with his harpoon, saying,
"Remember me."
Now we can't show the pole. It's too bloody. YouTube will get mad at us. But the detail I love about it is that the harpoon hooks on the open mouth of Joe's mask. So this mask that's normally closed, that was only open for one scene when Joe screamed over Angharad, is now open for just this 1 second to give Furiosa an opening to pull this awesome move. But it's not Joe as the ultimate threat, it's the stain of his progeny. So Rictus is the last villain they have to kill, which Nux does by pulling the sacrifice play and rolling the war rig right through that narrow canyon pass. Because of his half-life, he's not allowed to see the promised land. The doof wagon crashes behind, so even the sounds of Joe's drums aren't allowed to make it through. All the instruments and the guitar fly at the camera. Other than the steering wheel and the guitar, all of these instruments were propelled practically in the shot. The role was actually performed by stunt driver Lee Adamson, and in that cab with him was the dummy of Nux, and George Miller from Video Village had thought that this was actually Lee with his head shaved. He saw that dummy crash on its head, and he thought Lee had died. As Furiosa clings to life, Max reverts to the function he began this movie serving as a blood bag. His blood is what brought Nux back from the brink, and now it brings Furiosa back from the brink. And he finally tells her his name.
My name is Max.
Now, some say Tom Hardy's facial tics here are kind of an impression of Mel Gibson's manic mannerisms. I guess I agree, but it's also just a manic energy that Tom Hardy gives in every role, like in Warrior, Venom, Inception. It's why he was cast in this movie. Now, don't get me wrong, Tom Hardy is great in this film, but I once read an interview, and I want to say it was with the director, Christopher McQuarrie. It was like a tweet that he gave, but the guy has since deleted a lot of his tweets, so I can't be sure. But I'm pretty sure he said that in his action movies, he casts actors for the way they look and the way they move in a frame, what he expects them to bring to the movie, and doesn't really expect them to do transformative acting, as that might conflict with his storyboarded vision for the movie. And he basically said it's totally okay to approach action filmmaking like this. And Mad Max Fury Road, I think, is a perfect example. Tom Hardy, like Max, has a job to do, he does it without taking over the movie, and sometimes the most heroic thing you can do is just support the driver from the back seat. That is what Nux, our most transformative character in my opinion, does in this movie. He's the one who makes the sacrifice play and crashes the war rig so that the others can escape. His final words to Capable are,
"Witness me."
Witness me, as in, tell my story. Now, the war rig has to be destroyed in this movie because returning in Joe's Giga Horse would have been the only way that the Citadel would let them get anywhere close to the elevator. And once they are close, Max is able to reveal Immortan Joe as mortal, resulting in this symbolic revolution, and the crowd is able to demand their assent. You need to win over the people. And as they rise, the wives allow the wretched to join, and the milk mothers unleash the Aquacola. Furiosa has her eyes swollen, shut, and bleeding, looking just like Max at the end of the Road Warrior. And the two heroes just give each other a knowing nod as Max chooses not to go with him, but just disappears into the crowd because there's more work for him to do, and both characters have earned their redemption. Now, when asked about the ending, George Miller said, "Very early on, I had Max going up to the top of the Citadel with them, but Tom Hardy picked that up very early. Max would never go. He wasn't even remotely ready for that. We end on the idea of Furiosa and the others taking over all the resources. It asks the question, are they going to do any better?" I love this question because, yeah, who knows how long Furiosa could hold the Citadel in this post-apocalypse, or whether letting the wretched up with them and then flooding people dying of thirst with water is really what's best for this society. The Vuvolini totally did horrible things to men and their cult. Really, anything could happen next. It's not about the ending, it's about the ongoing journey. So who killed the world? Well, in these survivors' eyes, yeah, it's mostly the men who did it, but really, all of us have blood on our hands, folks. This movie lifts up both Max and Nux to help redeem it alongside Furiosa. She's indisputably the most badass hero of this movie, but she doesn't doesn't do it alone. She needs their help. Like George Miller and his wife, Margaret Sixel, editing this perfect movie together, hand in hand. It takes all of us working together to fix this broken world. Miller leaves us with a quote from the first History Man. Where must we go, we who wander this wasteland in search of our better selves? This survival tale is a myth told by the histories of this dystopia as an example of how to be a good person. You take a backseat. You don't demand glory. You don't complain. You do the work and you bleed so that others can live. And you just keep moving down that fury road. For my money, this was the best film of 2015. And while it was nominated for 10 Oscars, including Best Picture and Best Director, it didn't win for those somehow. Thanks Spotlight, thanks The Revenant. Its biggest wins were for editing and production design. It really deserved a sweep. But I want to know from you. Comment down below. Now, I've been really trying hard to read as many of the comments and engage with as many of you as you can. I really specifically love how you on the Deep Dive channel have really been writing some of the best, most engaging, insightful comments. So I want to know from you, what did this movie do to change the way that you looked at movies? Because I know it did. Let me know in the comments below. Please subscribe to the Deep Dive. Subscribe to all the channels of the New Rockstars Network. You can follow me on all platforms at EA Voss. And I will witness you next time, my divers of the deep!